has a new prime minister. Former cabinet member Scott Morrison was sworn in on Friday, becoming the fifth person to take the job in the past 5 years. Now he's appealing to voters and businesses alike with calls for unity. Mr. Morrison's predecessor, Malcolm Turnbull, was forced out of office Friday by rivals within his own party. As Scott Morrison assumes his new role, the former treasurer turned leader is already looking to shape economic policy. He made an appeal to voters Friday saying, quote, "The best form of welfare is a job." He says he believes Australians should keep more of what they earn. Australia's stock markets have fluctuated on the news from Canberra. Stocks were gripped by a three-day losing streak as the leadership crisis played out this week, but rebounded Friday as Mr. Morrison took office. The CEO of Australian airline Qantas says the uncertainty was, quote, "disappointing and frustrating." Alan Joyce called the shakeup not helpful. Let's talk more about this leadership change and the market reaction with Steve Keen, professor of economics at Kingston University, joining me via Skype from Amsterdam. Steve, thank you so much for joining us. You know, the insurgency in Turnbull's party started, as I understand it, because MPs actually wanted to install a man named Peter Duncan as PM. And he's been, that Peter Duncan guy's been compared to Donald Trump, actually. And yet Morrison ends up prime minister in the end. Those guys, neither Duncan or Morrison would have been elected. So what are voters thinking? Are they happy with this change?
Oh, actually, you've got his name wrong, but that's not a problem because you're going to be forgotten in politics
Peter
in a very,
Dutton.
Very rapid
Excuse
order.
Excuse me, Peter
name
Dutton.
Is Dutton. Yeah. And he's actually been mistaken for funnily enough, he's been mistaken for an American entrepreneur selling popcorn who's now become the people's prime minister choice down here, which is quite a hilarious side trip for the whole thing. It's really a farce. The Australian politics has been a farce pretty much for the last 10 years. And I've actually compared this now to, at least in Australia, a famous incident where an Australian won a skating gold medal at the Olympics in 2002 in Salt Lake City, not because he was the best skater, but because the four people ahead of him all fell over and he was the only one standing crossing the line. So I see ScoMo, as he's known down in Australia, as the Stephen Bradbury of Australian politics.
All right, but he's... That's an interesting metaphor. I wouldn't have thought Australians were particularly good at ice skating. But look, Morrison is not, he's not a nobody. He's been in charge of the economy for, what, the last 3 years. The economy's been doing pretty well. What else do we know about Mr. Morrison and what his policies will be like going forward? Certainly investors seem to like this change.
Well, I mean, he's got more, if I was going to use a different expression, but he's got more backbone than Malcolm Turnbull had and less ideology than Tony Abbott, who was the previous Conservative Prime Minister. There's more likelihood he's going to be doing stuff that supports the property lobby because for a substantial part of his pre-political career, he was a lobbyist for the property lobby in Australia, when, of course, Australia has the world's longest running property bubble. So he'll be doing all he can to maintain that bubble. And it's bursting right now. So he'll be pumping government money to keep the property market alive. That'll make him relatively popular in Australian business and potentially with the electorate. But I think he's really on a hiding to nothing to be the last Liberal Party Prime Minister before the Labor Party takes over at the next election, which he'll delay for as long as possible.
Okay, you bring up a lot of stuff there, sir. So let me parse out what you said. First of all, Australia's economy hasn't experienced a recession in more than a quarter century. But you just referred there to one of the economic pressures that was facing Turnbull. From what I understand, wages are extremely stagnant, and also there are high housing costs. So were those economic pressures playing in to voters' minds, and did that lead in part to Turnbull, his fall?
No, it's entirely due to actually personal animosities that go back in the Liberal Party 45 years when both Tony Abbott, who was the previous Prime Minister that Malcolm shafted to get the job, and he were both students at Sydney University, both on the Conservative side. Tony staunchly Conservative, actually like a throwback to the 1950s and McCarthyist politics, whereas the Turnbull was more a suave 1970s conservative in that sense. They hated each other at university and spent their entire time shafting each other there. And now they're spending their time shafting each other in Australian politics in the House of Parliament. And I think the most sensible thing that Scott Morrison could do would be appoint Tony Abbott to be High Commissioner to London and get rid of him and remove that particular cancer from the Liberal Party. Mm. Whether he has the guts to do it, we'll find out shortly.